astigmatism and cataract surgery. And the second is about spectacle independence following cataract surgery. Well, I have no financial disclosure, but I did learn a lot about astigmatism during our stay at Shenzhen with Dennis Lam. Well, what this talk basically includes is what modern phaco surgery can achieve, how do we correct astigmatism using the surgically induced astigmatism, the astigmatic keratotomies, the toric IOLs, when do we combine them, what are the keys to success, what the management algorithm is, and is there a role of femtosecond laser assisted laser astigmatic correction. So what does modern cataract surgery actually do? It does help in improving clarity. It causes a refractive enhancement, one core presbyopia correction using either a monovision, a multifocal, or an accommodating IOL. Well, in glaucoma, it does open up the drainage angle, especially narrow angles, and does help reducing intraocular pressure too. So a little about astigmatism. The total astigmatism, manifest astigmatism, could be both corneal and lenticular. It is the rule astigmatism in younger age, and it becomes an against the rule astigmatism as one ages. This is due to steepening of the cornea in the horizontal meridian. With aging, there is a decrease in the upper eyelid pressure on the cornea, which is because of the decrease in tone of the orbicularis muscle. The aim of any cataract surgery should also include the management of corneal astigmatism. Well, how can we actually change corneal astigmatism? This is by either changing the corneal shape, that is flattening the steep meridian, or by steepening the flat meridian. So how to flatten the steep meridian? This is either taking incision in the steep meridian or by relaxing cuts along the steep meridian. Or you steepen the flat meridian by taking compressive sutures. The second is by neutralizing. And how do you do that? That is by using toric intraocular lens. Well, what is surgically induced astigmatism? This refers to an astigmatism that is induced by your surgery. In generally using phacoemulsification surgery, a 2.4 incision is supposed to be most astigmatic neutral. The 2 and the 2.8 does cause a little more astigmatism than a 2.4. The magnitude of surgical induced astigmatism, it has a flattening effect. It depends on the size of your incision, the location of your incision, the amount of intraoperative manipulation that you do. Are you doing a double SI or you're doing just single main incision? It depends on the age, the length, and the corneal elasticity. The effect of a surgical induced astigmatism is most nasally, and it reduces superior, superior nasal, superior temporal to temporal. So a temporal incision is probably most astigmatic neutral. If you do an on-axis primary incision, it causes a reduction of around 0.25 to 1.25 diopters of corneal astigmatism, depending on the length and the width of your incision. So if you were to just do an SIA alone, a diamond knife is probably preferred, but even the money knives are good. These videos are from Shenzhen, where you can see that we have there was a double SIA done in the left in this video. So the second is astigmatic keratotomies. This is where you take limbal relaxing incisions to about approximately 90% of the depth. It can correct up to 3 diopters, but it depends on a lot of factors. It depends on the incision, the length, the depth, and the regularity. It depends on patient's factors, the corneal elasticity and wound healing factor, and it also depends on the surgeon's steadiness of his hands, his or her hands, as to how deep the cut can be through the and how regular the can be through the cornea. So a longer incision smaller optical zone, less uncut tissue, and an increased in all effect the final outcome of a limbal relaxing incision. You have different nomograms. One is the Fukuyama's nomogram. It differs whether you have a with the rule or an astigmatic or against the rule astigmatism. Depends on the age, but you will never do a limbal relaxing incision if you have a thin cornea. So you need to do a pachymetry in all of these patients, including peripheral pachymetry. There are other nomograms. This is more for knowledge. The James Hayes, the NAPA nomogram. You have the LRICalculator.com where you can, it's managed by Abbott, where you can go in, you can fill in the patient's name, you can fill in the data, and it will tell you where you should actually do your limbal relaxing incision. So, well, this is just to show you how a limbal relaxing incision is done. This is using a AK marker. You mark it, and then you, with your blade perpendicular, you set the gauge to around either 5.5, 0.55, or 0.6, depending on your how thick your cornea is, and you run an incision parallel to the limbus. So if you were to do just a astigmatic keratotomy or an LRI, you can do it for around greater than 1 to 1.5 diopters. But if it's greater than 1.5 diopters, the risks may outweigh its benefits. This is because of the incision irregularity. There are chances that you can perforate through the cornea. And if it's too long in LRI, you would probably compromise on your phaco incision. The potential complication, can get a decreased corneal sensation, discomfort, infection. You can have an over or an under correction. You can perforate through the cornea, and you can more commonly induce an irregular astigmatism. So probably if you want to do a corneal astigmatism correction using an LRI, if you have just around a 0.25 to 0.5, you can make a on incision steep axis incision. If it's 0.5 to 1 to 1.2, you can think of a limbal relaxing incision, but if it's generally more than 1 to 1.5, you would definitely want to go in with a toric, and none of these surgeries where you need to do an extra incision. We'll go on to a little about toric IOLs. They're available in cylindrical powers of 1.5 to 6. Diopters. It can correct pre-existing regular corneal astigmatism, which ranges from 0.75 to 4.75. These are available as both monofocal and multifocal. You have the Alcon IQ toric series from T3 to T9. You also have the Technis toric, which can correct up to 3 diopters in the corneal plane. So I won't go into the theory of those lenses, but what you need to do from the clinical point of view, you need to get an accurate preoperative corneal astigmatism. You need to segment SIA, the surgically induced astigmatism, from the primary incision. And you need to also target postoperative spherical equivalent IOL, which needs to be pre-cleared because these aren't generally kept in stock. What are your contraindications for a toric IOL? They are an irregular astigmatism where you could have trauma, surgery, corneal scars, and diseases. You could have a zonular instability and posterior capsular dehiscence. These are patients where you would avoid doing a toric IOL, say a pseudo exfoliation. Patients with poor pupillary dilatation, these are relative, but with the use of the BHEX or the Bhattacharjee ring, you can see the edges of the marking, so it makes your toric IOL insertions much easier. Patients with chronic dry eye, narrow palpebral fissure, deep set eye, these are again patients where there's a relative contraindication to a toric IOL. Well, what's important is you need to choose your case well. You need to use the correct formula, and the Barrett's online is the most accurate. So Barrett says that you have to consider every patient as an patient who has an astigmatism, even if your refraction is zero, and fill in the data, and based on the data, you decide whether you would want to put a toric IOL or no. So if it's generally greater than 1.5 diopters astigmatism, it's prudent to use a toric IOL. You also have to know whether you'd want to use whether you're going to leave the patient a little with or against the full astigmatism. Well, what may go wrong? You could have a post-op rotation of axis, like in this patient. And if you have a 10-degree misalignment, you have lost around 30% of corneal toricity. And if you have a 30-degree misalignment, you have lost 100%. So if you, by mistake, put the steep as the flat axis in your calculation, you can actually increase the astigmatism to 200%. So if you were to look over here, these lenses, any one of them could rotate. And this is a patient who was preoperatively day one. His astigmatism was, his IOL was in position, but by day seven, it had rotated. Needed repositioning. So this is the small video. This is the video by Professor Lam. Oh, I'm sorry, cannot play. On how to reposition an IOL. Oh, it's here. So it's important that when you're repositioning the IOL, you first separate the bag. You loosen the adhesions which are around, and then rotate it. So when do you do it ideally? Well, you could do it better late than never, but I have also done, this is my patient where we have done it. He was a patient with high astigmatism. We just needed to rotate the lens by around 10 degrees, and this was nearly a year post-surgery, post-initial surgery, where the additions can be dense, so you need to separate them using a second instrument. Try to release the knob of the edge of the haptic and then rotate it. Well, this patient, we did end up from three diopters to a zero diopter with just around, I think it was 10 to 15 degrees of astigmatic rotation. So, well, how do you calculate how much you need to rotate? You have this site called astigmatismfix.com. You need to go in. You need to fill in all your data. It also tells you, it has a tutorial that tells you what you need to do. And once you do it, it will tell you, well, this is the amount of astigmatism which is there. And this is how much you will have to rotate to get reduce the astigmatism. Well, what are the keys to success? The keys to success are an accurate measurement of the corneal astigmatism. You also have to take into account positional cyclotorsion. So it's always good to measure the astigmatic axis by at least three methods. We do the keratometer or the autokeratometer. We don't use the corneal topography that often, but we use, unless it's a, or a pentacam if it's a high astigmatism, and the lens chart. The other methods which you could use are the ITS ray tracing system, the pentacam, and the Galilei analyzer. So you could also measure both the anterior and the posterior corneal surfaces. Really does it correct calculates the total corneal power and also determines the astigmatism. You also have the Varion, which can help you can be your third or fourth way to calculate the astigmatism. How do these all differ? So the Varion takes into just the central corneal power between 0.8 to 1.2 millimeters. The lens star takes a wider area, that is around 1.6 to 2.3. The optical or biometry, they take around 2.5, and the manual takes even larger. So these are all which generally, I'm sorry, the second was the lens star, the third was the IO master, and fourth was the manual. So you could take three of them and check and counter-check whether the astigmatism axis and the degree of astigmatism is the same when you measure three using these three methods. So the eye trace is probably ahead of its time. It combines the Placido disc corneal topography with ray trace aberrometry. It analyzes the entire visual system. It provides the corneal curvature, power maps, it measures the angle alpha, it calculates the corneal, the internal and total higher order aberration. It also has a toric calculator, a toric caliper, and you can also, if you have an eye trace, you then need not go to the astigmatism fix.com. You just fill in your data here and eye trace would tell you how much to correct. The next is surgical induced astigmatism. This is something which all of you must do. You just need to go to the drhill.com site and fill in your number of surgeries and your pre and post-operative data, where you can each determine your personal surgical induced astigmatism. So if there is even a greater than 10 degrees in your axis or more than a 0.5 difference in your degree of astigmatism, you will need to use other methods or need to counter check and check whether your the measurements of astigmatism are accurate or no. So I asked Meenakshi to prepare something about posterior corneal astigmatism. So these are her slides. I'll run through them. What is the astigmatism classification? So what is with the rule, what is against the rule, what is oblique, where the principal medians are perpendicular but they are not horizontal or vertical, and bioblique, where the principal meridians are not perpendicular. So I'd also ask you about posterior corneal astigmatism. He's tried to explain it here. Whether we should consider it or no. I'll go through this. And this is how you can measure the posterior corneal astigmatism using these different methods. These are the references which is given. So if any one of you want to know more about it, you can contact her. So the posterior corneal astigmatism, it generally acts as a minus lens. It is generally against the rule and it is generally stable over the time. So if you have a with the rule astigmatism, you will have to overcorrect by a factor of 1.38. And if you have an against the rule, you will have to undercorrect by a factor of 0.6. So these are the formulae which can take into account the posterior corneal astigmatism, that is the Bayer nomogram and the Barrett toric nomogram. The Barrett is available on the ASCRS website, so you can fill into it. They help calculate the total toric power using also the posterior corneal astigmatism. The other thing you need to take into account is your positional cyclotorsion. This can range from a 0.5 to a 17.5 degrees. There are different methods that you can do to improve your accuracy. You can see this example of this patient where the preoperatively the markings are here. But when you take the patient in, there is a 15 degree change in there's a cyclotorsion by around 15 degrees once the patient is lying. So how do you generally mark the axis? This is from the Alcon website. This could be asking the patient to look straight and while they are looking straight market. But a easier way would be to, or a more accurate way is to mark the axis on a slit lamp. This could be in a dilated or an undilated pupil. And undilated is here, since you can go right through the pupillary axis. You mark it and also do an additional surface marking, like is there a blood vessel, a pigmentation, is there any pterygium, is there a pinnicula, what is there which will help you surface mark that axis, the horizontal axis. The other way that you could do is using the superimposing lenticule. This is comes with a hat sheet. You take a photograph and put a reticule over it, and you can then take a printout of that. The Varion, well, this is another accurate or a good way to mark your axis. It helps to plan your incision, place your IOL. It's probably, if connected, what we do at there is use the pen drive, but you can always have them connected through the LAN, the machine which is down in the OPD with your machine which is there on the microscope. So when you, how do you approach a toric IOL? You first calculate your SIA, you check your cyclotorsion, you look at your both your corneal and your scleral wounds. You need to see that your rexus is not too large or too small. You would want just an approximate 0.5 covering of the IOL, because if it's too small, it can cause a phimosis and cause your lens to move. If it is more than, if it's a large rexus, the lens can sometimes decenter. So when you're placing the IOL, you need to see that your corneal light reflex and Purkinje image match. You also use the Varion if you have one. You always undercorrect by around 5 to 10 degrees, because once you move the OVD, is when you then will do the final alignment at the cell line. So the algorithm which would be easiest to follow is do K reading, see that they match, do a corneal thickness. If your cornea is too thin, less than 500, do no astigmatic keratotomy. If it's on 0.25, 1.5, you can do a surgical induced astigmatism. If it's around 1, I wouldn't go by 2.5 now, it would be 1 to 1.5. You can think of an astigmatic keratotomy, but there are many cons to it. And if it's more than 1.5, you're better off doing a toric intraocular lens. So femto lasers, well, does it actually make your the incisions are supposedly more accurate? There are new nomograms that have come. There is no risk of perforation. But there have been a lot of discussions and studies now about lot of reports about astigmatism, irregular astigmatism developing because of even femto second laser assisted keratotomies. The other thing was, you would, once you make the incision, you still need to separate it with a hook. So people are now still not sure whether its long-term effect is really going to help or no. Well, it's obviously much more expensive. The femtosecond lasers, nomograms are there. There which have been developed, like the Donenfeld nomogram for femto laser also. The take-home message, you have to think of astigmatism in every phaco surgery of yours, every cataract surgery of yours. You have to correct. If it is less than, you should be able to correct about 6 diopters of astigmatism using a toric IOL and on-axis incisions by using your surgical-induced astigmatism. The LRIs and the astigmatic keratotomies are becoming less popular. There is regression. You're ending up with irregular astigmatism. It's important to choose your method correctly. You're important to have accurate pre-op keratometry reading, and do not make errors due to positional cyclotorsion. Also remember, astigmatism correction is still an enigma. We do not have a foolproof method. You cannot end up and tell a patient that I'm going to, with a toric or either one of these, give you a zero astigmatism. Well, thank you. If there's any questions, I can take them now, or I can go on to the technical.
Dr. Vineet, Meena here. So I'm going to ask a very basic question. How do you counsel a patient for toric? And second is, some of these forums mentioned that if a patient has with the rule astigmatism and they're closer to being elderly, you don't correct if it's one diopter with the rule. So I just wanted an opinion on that.
Yeah, so whenever a patient comes to me and I have to advise him a toric, counseling is very important. You never tell them that you're going to go for a sphere. You tell them that your amount of astigmatism would reduce. That's what the aim is, and you're correcting it using your toric ocular lens. These are more expensive, but your unaided vision would be better. So a patient who has around a 3 or a 2 to higher astigmatism there, and if you're even able to get it down to 0.5, patients do have a wow factor about it. So never tell them you're going to correct your astigmatism completely. Tell them it depends on your wound healing. It depends on many factors. I also tell all my patients that if I'm putting a toric IOL, I may need to take you back to the operation theater to dye the lens in case there is a movement of the lens. It happens very rarely, but it is something which I always tell my patients, stop. It could happen in 1 week, it could happen in 2 weeks, or it could happen later. About adults, about the, is that, does that answer your counseling question?
Yes, thank you. And yeah.
The second How one will you is, know that yes, the lens is...
Sorry?
How do you know, how do you check that the toric lens is rotated? Do you dilate the patient in the postoperative period, or you wait till class appointment to...
Yes, I do check on my first week when the second post-op visit when they come. I do dilate the toric patients to check. I also ask them about their clarity of vision. So if they even say that they have a little less clarity of vision, I dilate and check where it is.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Surya, I think the best thing we need to do is get a visual acuity done on the first post-operative day and all these patients, so you know the unaided vision. The patient is comfortable on that day, that is the best way. Most of the times, the rotation occurs immediately after surgery. That's what they say. It can occur 1 hour to 1 to 2 hours. That is the most. So some of them say suggest even before the patient is discharged, have a look, because the pupil will be still dilated and you can make a find out, because this is a new thought that they say the maximum rotation can occur within 1 to 2 hours after surgery, because the changes that occur in the anterior chamber, all the and the aqueous dynamics which can get corrected, or the residual visco which is left over would absorb, and if any changes can occur, it occurs in the first 1 or 2 hours.
The other reason for that is that you all your toric cases, you need to leave it tighter. You would not want to leave the in any way a little softer. You give the patient postoperative dymo, tell them you're leaving the toric, you have a toric IOL, so I'm leaving the eye a little tighter. Because in case you have any leak from your side force there, micro leaks also, and your pressures come down, the IOL can rotate.
Okay, so you never do you put torics in along with trabeculectomies, or you never do that?
No,
because anyway you'll produce an astigmatism in your trabeculectomy.
You don't know what astigmatism you're going to get, because in a trabeculectomy you always want to, you're more worried about glaucoma part of the conjunctiva, and your incision is not, you want to save as much subjunctiva as you want. So no, not in trabecular.
Okay. Thank you.
So Meena, your second question, yes, as you age, you with the rule becomes against the rule. With the rule does give little clarity, gives what there's a group in Pune which talks about multifocality in monofocal IOLs with an SICS incision. So they say leaving the patient with a little bit of astigmatism actually gives them a complete range of vision. So easy way is not to think so much is to put your this one into the Barrett's toric catheter. It will tell you, it will take into account age, it takes into account your with the rule, against the rule, it takes into account the posterior corneal astigmatism, it will tell you. With the newer Barrett's formulas, I have tended to start offering toric IOLs much more. So even if it's a 1 to between a around a 1.5, I do, and if the patient, I will counsel the patient, and if they're willing, I would go in even for a 1.5 now.
Thank you.
Vinit, can I add one point?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So I think currently we cannot advise, ideal thing is to get the newer IOL masters, or the IOL Master 700, which takes care of the anterior and posterior, and it automatically suggests whether the patient needs a toric or non-toric. So now newer thought is even up to 0.5 to 0.75 is good to correct, even if the IOL Master suggests, based on the Barrett Universal 2 toric calculators, it suggests if you need to go for a toric, it's even good to consider even for a lesser astigmatism. So please do not consider just anterior astigmatism at all, because if you only do a K reading and the patient comes to you, don't use that as a guide. But a guide will be always ask your DBR person to do an IOL master, which will automatically pick up the astigmatism. So they are the best people to identify good candidates and send it back to you so that you can counsel along with the DBR results. So that is one way which we need to look at it.
Any other questions, or can I go on to the next one? Can I go to the second part? So this is about spectacle independence after cataract surgery. I have no financial stress. I did get a few slides from JNG and Alcon. And Nidarshana did give me this list of questions about what can come in your DNB exam. So you need to go through this and know most of these which are there. Well, I'll start off with monovision. This is what is monovision? It is a form of deliberately induced anisometropy in which one eye is adjusted for near and the other for a distance. But what is easier and what is probably better to do is a mini monovision, what I generally do, where I would put in an intermediate power in one eye and discuss with the patient for the second eye whether they would want, they do more of distance work or they do more of reading, and then plan whether the second eye would be distance or near. There is less degree of anisometropia here, it's only around a 1 or a 1.5 or maximum 1.75. There is less neuroadaptation required. The stereopsis, contrast sensitivity, and vision in scotopic conditions in these patients is better. The second part is what is conventional monovision, which where you correct the dominant eye for distance. And a cross monovision where the dominant eye is corrected for near. Well, I don't look too much into this. I discuss it with the patient. Whichever has the first eye is where I plan to aim for an intermediate. Does that actually make a difference? No, there have been studies which say that whether you do a crossed or a uncrossed monovision, the patient satisfaction is the same. Well, how do you check for a dominant eye? This is easy, which probably all of you should know how, whether which eye of yours is dominant. The Miles test is one which is probably the easiest. You keep looking at some distance object, make a triangle out of your hand, and focus on that object with both eyes. You keep making the triangle smaller and smaller, getting your hands closer to your face. And once you get it close enough and that object within the triangle, within your triangle, completely filling the triangle, you close one eye. So if, say if you close your right eye and you see that the image has disappeared, then your right eye is your dominant eye. If you close your right eye and the image is still there, then your left eye is the dominant eye. So this is something which you should know how to do, and you should do it on yourself too. It's known as the Miles test. There are other ways to do it. You could do it by the convergence near point test, the pinhole test, or the lens fogging method. So we'll then go on to the other part about multifocal IOLs. So when you're looking at an intraocular lens, what do you actually want to look at? You want to look at whether this lens is spheric or aspheric. What is the refractive index? What is the Abbe number? What material is made up of? So what is the difference between a spherical and a spherical lens? A spherical lens is when all the incoming light rays end up focusing at a different point. It affects the resolution and clarity. It makes it harder to get sharp objects, as you can see here. It's not a one-point focus. Whereas if you look here, this is a patient who, this is a lens which is aspheric. You have a one-point sharp focus where each ray is bent at a different degree. You have a positive and you have a negative spherical aberration. And just like a negative spherical aberration is when they focus behind, and a positive spherical aberration is when they focus in front. If you look at a best corrected visual acuity, it is comparable between a spherical and an aspherical. Then the question comes that why should you use an aspheric lens? Well, a spherical lens is a constant curve on surface variable power of the lens. These are easier to manufacture. The aspheric lenses have a variable curve on a surface. So there is a constant power at the periphery of the lens. The more difficult to manufacture. The greater the power of the spherical lens, the more is the spherical aberration. So it, say if you have a 17 diopter or a 34 diopter, the amount of spherical aberration is 4 times higher in a 34 diopter lens. More the spherical aberration, more is the MTF. We'll come to that. Also, in larger pupil sizes, you have an increased spherical aberration and a degraded image quality. So, various studies have shown that whatever the asphericity of the lens, you should correct it with the asphericity of the cornea, and you need to end up with a slight positive corneal, a positive total spherical aberration. It is here that you have the best optical performance. Irrespective of the pupil size. So you have different lenses which have different asphericity. The thickness has plus minus 0.27. The Acrisoft is a minus 0.17, and a spherical is around the plus 0.15. So the thickness, these have a prolate anterior surface. The Alcon, the Acrisoft have a prolate posterior surface. You have lenses where you have prolate surfaces, and all of these aspheric IOLs, these do show better photopic and mesopic contrast sensitivity at both the medium and high spatial frequencies. But what's important in aspheric lenses is that you need to be well centered. And the performance of the lens, these decrease as the pupil dilates in mesopic conditions. So a human cornea has a positive 0.27 to 0.3 spherical aberration. The natural human crystalline lens has a negative spherical aberration of around -0.2. So when you do a total aberration, it comes to around a +0.1. And it's because of this slightly positive spherical aberration is that you get vision better than 20/20. That is the 6x4.5 or the 20x15. Now the lens changes these develop over time. As cataract develops, the spherical aberrations negative or positive. And it's also important to remember that it is not possible to correct all the spherical aberration. You should just aim to lower the spherical aberration since it gives contrast sensitivity. Well, what about refractive index? This is low versus high. How does it affect the visual quality? The high refractive index means a high dispersion and a low Abbe number. We come to the Abbe number again. So you can see here, different lenses have different refractive indices. And as the refractive index is lower, your dispersion is lower, your Abbe number is higher. What is Abbe number? Well, this is what I had asked Amber to prepare, and this is what he has prepared about it. How do you calculate an Abbe number? So, Abbe number, basically, what does it tell you? It quantifies the material dispersion. So, optical materials which are characterized by a low Abbe number, they have a greater chromatic dispersion. Thus, you have a longitudinal chromatic aberration. So, what is longitudinal chromatic aberration? Is the inability of the optical system to refract the incident rays of different focal, different colors onto the same plane. So, each lens has a different Abbe number. So, this is what is chromatic aberration. So, when you have rays of light, instead of focusing at one point, you know that according to the Vidyor, the white bends more and the red bends less. So normal eye does have a chromatic aberration. A phakic eye, this has around 1.38 diopters of chromatic aberration. Pseudophakic eyes is a little higher, and this is based on the material that you use. So the aspheric lenses, the monofocal lenses, generally do not correct for chromatic aberration, but the multifocal lenses like the extended depth of focus, the Tecnis, they do correct for chromatic aberrations, and thus you can get better contrast or contrast sensitivity equal to a monofocal, even with a extended depth of focus lens. So this brings us to the next point. What are the different type of lenses? So we'll start first with the refractive. First, refractive IOLs, these use differing areas of refractive power to achieve their multifocality. They have annular zones. They were the first lenses which came in. The Rizom was one of the most popular of these lenses. They were good for distance and intermediate, but they were pupillary dependent, very sensitive to lens centration. They were intolerant to kappa angle, and the halos and glare was quite significant, along with the loss of contrast sensitivity. To overcome these came the diffractive lenses. So what are these diffractive lenses? These are based on the principle that every point of a wavefront can be thought of being as its own source of secondary wavelets, which is it's based on the Huygens Fresnel principle. The amplitude of the optic field is the sum of all of these wavelengths. So if you look at, try to understand it, if this is a normal ray of light and you have a lens medium to it, you do have a change in your speed of light. This, along with the diffractive technology, can help you bend the rays of light and get them to focus at one particular point. This is the diffractive technology. It has been used extensively in multifocals, but it's also used in different in other industries like the photographic, the astronomy, the laser industries. And based on these diffractive designs which you have here, you can have different shapes, different height, different spacing, which could look like either one of these. You could end up with different diffractive principles. So if you're they also allow these diffractive parts cause the rays of light to come, have both positive and constructive interference. So this causes those which are in phase to add on and which are out of phase to get cancelled, and because of which you can end up with two focus points, the one for far and for distance. And since there are two focus points, you end up with halos and glares. There is no transition between the two. It causes an equal distribution of light in both foci. Thus, it causes a loss of around 18% of light. So if in a monofocal, you have 100% light entering. In a diffractive IOL, you could get not more than 82% entering. The newer trifocals like the Panoptix, they also work on the diffractive platform. They have intermediate foci, which causes the formation of a third intermediate. So about adopization, this is again what Amber has prepared. Adopization is basically what the Alcon technology, where you have a gradual reduction in diffractive step height from the center to the periphery. So this reduces the glare caused by the defocused near light. So the diffractive IOLs, the ones which most of us will know are the Acrisoft Restore and the Technis multifocal. The Restore are actually bifocal, not actually multifocal. They are a misnomer. They are aspheric. They have a central diffractive region of around 3.6. And as we discussed, they are apodized. They have a peripheral part which is also dedicated to distance vision, so that when the pupil dilates, the distance vision gets better. It is available in different powers, the 2.5, the 3, and the 4, which correct different powers at the spectacle plane. The thickness, these have a posterior diffractive surface and an anterior aspheric surface. These also come in different sizes, the 2.75, the 3.25, and the 4 diopters. The newer part of the lenses is the EDOF lenses, or the extended depth of focus lenses, where instead of just one point, you have a elongated focal point, so that you do not have you have a continuous range of vision, and you have reduced aberrations like glare and halos. Well, there are three types of technology which are used in the extended depth of focus lenses. The first is the etchet technology. So if you were to look at a monofocal, this is how the 100% light distribution occurs. It's a bifocal, you have a distribution. It causes the rays of light to focus in front and back. And with an extended depth of focus, you have a, with a symphony, you have a, not a point, but a range of foci. This is how an elongated focus of extended depth will look. This is how a distant single focus, a monofocal will look when you correct it for distance, and this is how bifocal will look where you have two distinct. This is on ray propagation. This is another the etchet design which will tell you. So in a monofocal you have a 1 point focus, multifocal you have a 2 point focus, which should actually be a bifocal, and in a technis you have an elongated range of focus. These are how the etchets are. This is of a multifocal. This is of an achromatic monofocal. So a monofocal, if you have HS on it or a diffractive monofocal, is when you're correcting for chromatic aberration. And this is for a this is the symphony. That is the extended depth of focus lenses. The profile height between each ring is different. And this, the space of the ring, the height of the profile, and the shape of the profile help give the advantages to the lens. So the thickness, it has an anterior spheric surface and the posterior achromatic diffractive surface with an etched design. It creates a achromatic diffractive pattern rather than a single focus. It has an elongated focus, which and a corrected and is also corrected for chromatic aberration. So the amount of light entering in a symphony IOL is 92% as compared to an 82% in a multifocal, and in a trifocal like a panoptic, it ranges from 85% to 88%. So the other extended depth focus, this is just for knowledge, is the pinhole lenses. We have the IC8, which is acrylic hydrophobic, and it just has a normal sort of a pinhole blackish disc in the pupil. It's quite similar to the Karma corneal inlay. You also have the bioanalogic intraocular lenses. You can go to their website, that is the swissmed.asia, and this is what they look like. They do not have haptics. But they have, they offer a range of distances through which they correct the power. So you then move on to the trifocal, where you have to compare a bifocal, a multifocal restore with a trifocal. How does it actually differ? You can see that the amount of diffractive zone in a multifocal is lesser as compared to a panoptics, where the diffractive zone is larger. The total central zone area is larger in a panoptics as compared to a restored 3-diopter lens. So this is how the diffractive technology in each of these in the multifocal is, and it varies as compared to that of a panoptics. They also have something which is called the Enlighten technology, where, if which I'll just try and explain. So if you have a traditional trifocal, you have just two-step height. So you have to add powers. That is one which is at 40 centimeter and an intermediate which is around 80 centimeters. So you have one distance which has the maximum amount of light going in. You have the first intermediate which is at 80 centimeters, then you have a second near which is 40 centimeters. So 80 is a little receded point. So what they came up with something which is known as the quadrifocal technology, where you have three-step height. That means you have three add powers. That would be at 40 centimeters, 60 centimeters, and at 120 centimeters. So 120 became the far intermediate area. So this became the quadrifocal technology, where you add the first at 40, 60, and 120. So your second intermediate has actually come a little closer. But what the Panoptics has also done is use Enlighten optic technology, where they have caused the 120 to actually go to the distance. You have the same amount of energy which is going to the distance, and the near instead of 80 in a trifocal is around 60 in a panoptic, and your near is 40 in both, which is same as a trifocal. They also have a high utilization, where in a panoptics around 88% of light can go in, so the total energy distribution is better. So the new kid on the block is the Technis Synergy. They had the soft launch today, where you have a combination of both the extended depth of focus and the diffractive technology, along with the ochromatic, which is there in the Symphony IOL. The refocus curve, we'll come to that, shows that it works for most distances. And it is good for intermediate and near as compared to a Symphony, which is good for distance to intermediate. This is better for intermediate to near. Well, what else should you know to decide if your IOL is good? You should go through this article. It's there on PLOS. It's a recent article in 2020 where you'll get to know how you have to access, how you have to know which of your lenses is good. So they looked at four IOLs. They looked at the Alcon monofocal, the Alcon multifocal, the panoptics, and the Symphony lenses. So they looked at different things. They looked at the optical quality. This was evaluated using the optical bench optospheric IOL Pro C, which is probably which is governed by the International Standard Organization. So it's everything is fixed about it. Then they looked at the optical quality parameters. They looked at the modulation transfer function and the through focus response. So what is modulation transfer function? You'll have all these company people come and tell you the MTF of my lens is good. They do not know. You have to know what the MTF is. MTF is the ability of a lens system to transfer an object's contrast to its image. From the human eye point of view, it is basically the visual performance. It describes the contrast sensitivity of the lens system. It is measured in a ratio, so if it is 1, it is 100%. And as it lowers, it means there is more loss of light. So this is how MTF is calculated or is plotted. This is the magnitude and this is the frequency. The next is the through focus response. This illustrates the IOL performance along its focal plane. And this depends on the optical design of the studied lens. It could have one or two peaks or three peaks depending if it is a monofocal, a bifocal or a multifocal lens. And the third, which you have to know, is about the lay propagation image. Which I'll discuss a little. So the lay propagation image, this is how the it is done. It's an experimental model. You can read about it in the article. It uses fluorescein solution. The lens is placed in a holder. You have a model cornea and monochromatic green light is given, which is then recorded in this, which gives this sort of a to tell you that it is a unifocal, one-focus lens. So they looked at four lenses. All of them have the same power, the plus 21 diopter. And each of them, the refractive indices we know is higher in Acrisoft as compared to a Technis platform. And also the spherical aberration. The Acrisoft has a minus 2 negative spherical aberration. Restore has a minus 0.1, the Panoptics has a minus 0.1, and the Symphony has a minus 0.27 spherical aberration. So once they did it, the images were taken. So this top thing is the ray propagation image. This is the TFR. This is for the 3 mm pupil. This is for the 4.5 mm pupil. And this is the MTF curve here. So for the Acrisoft, you can see that there is one single focus. You can see the which is matched which the with the TFR. It shows one peak over here. At 4.5, you can see that the peak is slightly smaller, but still there is and this ray propagation is slightly wider. The MTF over here is around a 0.8. Whereas this is in a dilated pupil comes down to around the 0.7. In a restore, you could see that there were two, one for near, one for distance. In the 3 millimeters, you can see that this is how the TFR was. And as the pupil dilated, the amount of light going in for the near reduced, whereas for the far increased. You had two humps in the MTS. This was around only around 0.4, between 0.4 to 0.5, but this reduced to around 0.3 in a dilated pupil. The panoptics, well, they had a sort of a three humps over here. This was the far, which had the maximum amount of distribution, as compared to a second intermediate, which was second near, and a third intermediate. So the MTF shows the same things over here. You have between a 0.3 and a 0.4 one hump, and two here, the intermediate and the near, where the near has a little more than the intermediate. When the pupil dilates, you can see that most of the light goes into the distance. As you can see, even in the MTF, it comes down from a 0.4 in a 3 mm pupil to a 0.2 in a 4.5 mm pupil. With the symphony, well, it showed more of only two. What you can also see is here is the dioptric power. We use the plus 21, but you see that in a 3 mm pupil, the light distribution was more in a near than in a distance, and at the 4.5 you see that the distance was more. So this was around a 0.3 to a 0.4, and this is again 0.3 to a 0.4. I'll come to the exact values, but you can see here that with a dilated pupil, the distance vision in a symphony actually improved. So in a the MTF values in an IQ for a 3 mm pupil and a 4.5 mm pupil were around 0.8 and a 0.7. In a resto was just a 0.45 and a 0.3. In a panoptics, a 0.37 and a 0.2. And a symphony was a 0.34 distance and 0.376 0.376 in a 4.5. This was for distance, this was for near. And this is for the intermediate here. So what the conclusion of this study is just basically for you to understand that you do have lab methods to know. You need to know how to read each of these ray propagation, the MTF and the TFR responses to understand how a particular lens behaves. Another way is to go through the defocus curve. What is a defocus curve? A defocus curve is a strong objective clinical measure in a patient who has already had the lens inserted into their eye. This addresses the main factor that drives the patient to consider presbyopia correcting IOL in the first place. So, well, how do you do it? You take a patient who's corrected for distance, that is zero by definition. Then you remove all the related residual refractive error, and then you start defocusing by putting 0.5 increments minus to till around minus 4 to around plus 1, and then you map it. So, well, this is how a defocus curve looks if you were to plot it. And these are defocus curves of four different lenses. This is the technology that is the one which is just coming in, which is supposed to be in physiological. Now, this is for distance. You can see that it is a 20/20 or 6/6 vision. It works, all of them work not so good till around a minus 1, but from minus 1 to a minus 2.5, it works well within the accepted norms of a 1 line decrease. And for a near, this is at a minus 3 near, it has around a 1 line fall. You compare these with the green, which is the Zeiss lens. Compare it with the blue, which is the Alcon panoptic lens, and the PHYS IOL fine lens, which we were talking about. So to look at the most physiological part of it, you will see that the synergy falls more into the physiology group. The Alcon panoptics is next close. it works well at 1.5, but not so well between that minus 1 to minus 1.5. And the other two don't work so well between the minus 1.5 to the minus 2. So you have a more continuous range of vision with a Symphony and a Synergy lens. So how do you interpret these? So these take into account everything. They take into effect the binocularity, the neural processing, the patient's adaptation. It gives you a good interpretation between lens vergence and the distance focus. So you need to understand what a defocus curve is. So then we go on to the assessment of a patient for a multifocal lens implant. Well, I asked Maitri to prepare this, and this is what she has mentioned. The points are, it depends on functional and occupational requirements of the patient. Which patients will you exclude? A hypercritical patient who says, if I'm going to spend not a 35,000, but I'm going to spend 60,000, I should get full vision for distance, intermediate, and near. You cannot promise the patient that. And Dr. Meena was saying, counseling is very, very important in these patients. You do not give it to patients who want perfect vision, who are night drivers, like a night drivers generally say, but these are not the patients who will generally come, but patients who work at night and who drive a lot at night, who do a lot of long distance night driving. These are patients you wouldn't want to advise a multifocal IOL. About the astigmatism, you would want them to be less than 0.75. That you would want to avoid them in patients who have corneal pathologies. If they have a dry eye, you would want to treat it. If they have any ocular surface disorder, you would want to treat it. If there's any amount of zonular weakness, you would not want to use it. If the patient has a monofocal in the other eye, you would again not advise the patient to. You advise against having a multifocal in this eye, and also in patients who have a previous refractive surgery. Well, biometry is important. So are these various angles. I'll come to that. Let's start with the biometry first. So you generally hear the company people say that you either should correct aim for zero or aim for a plus. So why is that? So if you were to actually look at this defocus curve, you will realize that if there is a 0.5 hyperopia, there is less than a one line loss of vision over here. Whereas if you have a minus one you're off the target by minus one, you have nearly a one line loss of vision. The whole defocus curve starts shifting. So if you are hyperopic, it starts getting a little closer. Whereas if you are myopic, it starts moving a little further distance. The second is corneal astigmatism, both the degree and axis. So well, a Symphony can tolerate up to around a 1.5 diopter of astigmatism. So if you have a patient who didn't have a pre-op astigmatism but got one induced because of surgical induced astigmatism, up to 1.5 the Symphony is still forgiving the other multifocal. But if you have someone with a 1.5, you would still want to use a multifocal toric. Well, the next is angle alpha and angle kappa. Well, this is what I told Amber to prepare. So he prepared about what an optical axis is. It extends from the anterior to the posterior pole of the eye. So basically what the optical axis is doing is it connects the four Purkinje images, which originate from a coaxial source of light. The second is the visual axis, which is defined from the fovea to the nodal point and out to the object. And more important is the pupillary center. So I'll come to that again in a little more detail. So if you were to look at the best way to measure it is the eye trace. So the iTrace has three points, the blue, which is the center here, which is the center of the limbus. That is the center of the limbus. The second is the red cross, which is the center of the visual axis, and the green, which is the center of the pupil. So the iTrace can tell you all three of them. You have to know what angle alpha is. Angle alpha is from the center of the limbus and the visual axis, the angle which is formed. It can be measured both with the pentacam or the iTrace. The IOL Master 700 gives it as the CWC, which is also the angle kappa. It can also be calculated in the LensStar 900. And if you have a angle alpha which is greater than 0.5, you would not recommend a multifocal. This is because the optical axis does not coincide with the visual axis. You will end up with aberration and unsatisfied patient, since the first and the third Purkinje images do not coincide. So alpha is important. Well, what about kappa? A kappa angle is the difference between the pupillary and the visual axis. This is more important in refractive surgeries, where the laser is laser vision correction is done through the pupil, is corrected centered on the pupil. But multifocals are also pupil dependent. They are also refractive surgeries, and they contribute. It can contribute to multifocal decentration and thus increase the photopic phenomenon. So OPSCAN can help measure the kappa angle, but there is also another known as a chord mu, which is the linear distance between the visual axis and the pupil center. It ranges from 0.2 to plus minus 0.11 meters. These are measured by the pentacam and the OCT. You have the actual and the apparent chord mus. So if you were to look at the angle kappa, it is the angle between the pupillary axis and the visual axis. And if you look here, the chord mu is classified as ranging between the optical visual axis and the pupillary axis. So this is the chord mu, and this is the angle kappa, which is converted into a linear number. So it is a linear number, which is an exact distance between the visual axis and the limbal center. Which of these is important? Well, IOL center on the dimensions of the capsular bag, so alpha is definitely relevant. Angle kappa on the visual axis and the pupillary center. So the angle kappa and the chord mu are nearly the same. The chord length values are reported in millimeters. And you can convert by using the formula of 1 millimeter to 7.5 to measure the angle kappa. Laser vision correction is on pupils, so kappa is important for refractive surgery. Multifocals are pupil dependent. So do remember, it's not just alpha, not just kappa, but the whole optical system of alpha and kappa, which are important in multifocal IOL. So, well, what are the complications? When Neha has prepared these slides, you could end up with photopic phenomenon and contrast sensitivity. You could have an residual emmetropia. In these patients, you can get PCO, and even a small amount of PCO can cause you a glare. If you have dry eye, you need to treat it. If you have pupils which are large or are irregular, so you're going to have patients who have more amount of aberrations and more complaints about glare and unclear vision. You could have an IOL decentration and so this is a good chart where she has, which you got, which will tell you when you have a blurred vision or a photo or a photic phenomenon, how do you go about it? So, well, what are photic phenomenon? These are ghost images. They're seen as rings around the light sources. So if you gently ask a patient who is had a multifocal, they'll say that they have multiple rings which they see. Whereas if you ask a patient who has had a symphony, they'll more or less tell you that they see two rings and a starburst. So this is the difference between a starburst, a glare from a normal light source. So you'll need to, they come and tell you, you see something like a star, then that's a starburst. And they see a halo, that is the glare. If this is how it looks like through a multifocal patient's eyes, when it's clear, this is the starburst, this is the glare, and this is the halo. So why do multifocal actually cause glare? Well, multifocals work on the principle of simultaneous vision, where one is on focus and one is not. The halos are caused because of an out-of-the-focus image. So in a monofocal, all the light goes to one point. In a bifocal, it goes to two points. So what is one color over there, you get a second halo around it. Whereas in extended depth of focus, you see that these halos are less because there is no distinct secondary focus. They also have corrected for chromatic aberration and the negative asphericity. So the next is neuroadaptation. And Purnika has prepared these about what is neuroadaptation. That is the process in which our brain reacts to the sensory input. You need to give it time. In a multifocal, you generally tell the patient that it could take about 3 to 6 months or even a year at time for you to completely adapt to the image. So different IOLs have different time. The with time, you'll see that the brain adapts to these images, and this is more or less what is neuroadaptation. So that's it, the clinical points. Multifocal, well, you have to have a careful patient selection. You need to check on the associated eye comorbidities, whether they're a glaucoma patient, whether they have any macular involvement like a macular edema and ARMD, whether they've already decreased contrast sensitivity, you wouldn't want to decrease it further. You look at the pupillary diameter, you measure the alpha and kappa angle, remember, you need neuroadaptation. If you do a binocular implant, neuroadaptation faster. Well, what is the disadvantage of monovision over multifocal? You have a decrease in dioptrics, there is a high anisometria, and in patients with a strong ocular dominance, especially, though at times it's shown not to be of much effect, there is less stereoactivity. There have been randomized trials comparing a multifocal versus monovision, and both management options had high levels of patient satisfaction. So when a patient is not able to afford a multifocal, monovision is a good choice. Very important to counsel the patient. Don't tell them that you're going to give them spectacle independence. Tell them that this lens reduces the dependency on glasses. So for most of your times, you may be able to manage without glasses. But for very fine vision, you may still need glasses because you could still have a residual astigmatism and a residual spherical error too. Explain to them that yes, you can get dysphotopsias. You can have a slight fall in contrast sensitivity. Your precise IOL calculations are important, so you would want to see that you're using an optical biometry. IOL centration is important, but this is again not dependent on you. It depends on the bag of, in which you have placed the IOL. And these are patients where if you have a post-operative refractive error, you do have a reduced efficiency and an unhappy. So the multifocal, they've been designed based on optical principles. They have improved over time. They do provide better uncorrected visual acuity, but can be responsible for all the side effects of reduced contrast sensitivity and photoptic vision. which are lesser with the extended depth of focus lenses. So always remember that the final choice is the patient's choice. It is not yours or mine. It is a discussion with the patient. It depends on how motivated the patient is to be free of spectacles, guided by how realistic expectations the patient have. I've had patients whom I've had to tell them very flatly that no, I am not going to put a multifocal IOL in your eye. You are not an ideal candidate for it. So I wouldn't do that for my relative. I'm not going to do that for you. I'm not going to do it for myself. I'm not going to do it for you. Once you tell them that, most patients do and then follow what you're telling them. Well, thank you, and I'm open to questions.
I just wanted to know, what do you prefer in your patients for multifocal and toric, whether it is a local or a topical anesthesia?
That's the patient's choice. I don't decide. Actually, my PG decides. When the patient is uncomfortable, they block themselves. When the patient is okay, it's fine. It doesn't matter. It's all a mental block. You could do either of them.
Because local induces more amount of cyclotorsion. So does it vary in your measurements? Like, how do you measure for the
We record before the patient, we always record in the sitting position before block, ideally on the slit lamp. So most of the time we have a slit lamp in our surgeon's room. So we do the marking there. I also tell the optometrist that when they have a high astigmatism to mark these points, which are a blood vessel at the 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock position, or at the 6 o'clock, whether there's any pigmentation there. So these are all the surface marks which help identify them. I've had patients where the patient was blocked, but I had luckily marked these, and there was a lot of cyclotorsion. So we didn't know whether which way to go. We stuck to our pre-op pigmentation points, and we ended up with a good result.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Hi, Vinith. Yeah, that was excellent. Exhaustive, and you covered up every point. That was an excellent presentation. Few things I think which you probably missed was Tecnis Eyhance lens. That is one, and which probably you might have used more lenses than anyone else. Probably you could add upon that.
Eyhance is not a multifocal IOL.
I'm not saying multifocal. I said that other lens which
come in the category. I haven't used much of Eyhance, so it works more on a refractive sort of a platform. So it's supposed to correct around one diopter of.
And there are also the newer ones which have come as the light adjustable IOLs, which are in the clinical trials happening in US.
Yeah, that Dr. Chang is working on. So those are where you put the lens in and then give light rays to correct all the aberrations which are there in the eye. It's wavefront technology which is used there.
Yeah. So there's one more which I thought the latest one is they're looking at centroid SIA, which is where all these multifocals and your toric IOLs, we need to look into centroid SIA with all the MICS and all these. So probably the SIA was the older term. Now it is currently using centroid SIA.
Sir, I think that's it, sir. Thanks a lot for the class.
Okay, welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all.